Today, we are going to try and understand what Lord Shri Krishna is instructing in the 16th chapter of Bhagavad-gita. So, the 16th chapter has a very interesting title, very attractive title for some. It's called the Divine and the Demoniac Nature. Divine and the Demoniac Nature. So, what I will request, I'll request for two of our wonderful devotees here, at least one or two of the wonderful devotees here, who shall help us make this more joyful. And we can make it more joyful, more relishable by hearing the verses of Bhagavad Gita in chapter 16. So, who is willing to volunteer to read for us the Sanskrit of the verses? Anybody would like to volunteer? In the front, Shivaguna Prabhu is there, Braj Prakash Prabhu is there. So what we will do is as follows. If you allow me, I'll give a brief introduction of the chapter. Then upon request, I'll request you to recite the verses in Sanskrit. And alongside, because we have limited time, so we'll not be going into the purport of every single verse. But alongside, I'll try to read some commentaries from Srila Prabhupada, from some of the other acharyas, so that we get an overview of what does this chapter, what are the significant instructions in this chapter. We are also doing this recording. I have requested Prabhu here to record so that some of our students who are pursuing their Bhakti Shastri, already we've covered the 16th chapter, but it's like a refresher so that we establish the context of what we are reading, and then this recording or chapter can be used for us to kickstart our Bhakti Shastri studies as well. So, other devotees who are present here, and if you're interested to encourage, feel encouraged after this to participate in this program of systematically studying Bhagavad Gita, you're welcome to join the Bhakti Shastri program. So, the chapter 16, titled The Divine and the Demoniac Natures, I will request for us to read the last verse of the chapter. I can hear myself breathe. The mic is very powerful. Okay, so we'll read the last verse in Sanskrit, please. 16th chapter, text number 24.
तस्मच्च छत्रस्तं प्रमाणं ते कार्य व्यवस्थितो ज्ञाता शास्त्रो विधानं कर्म कर्तुमिहर्हसि.
One should therefore understand what is duty and what is not duty by the regulation of the scriptures. Knowing such rules and regulations, one should act so that he may gradually be elevated. Purport and translation by His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Now, the last verse actually gives us the important message. When we will read from the beginning of the chapter, by the time we come to the end of the chapter, there's a specific message that Krishna wants us to appreciate. The overall context of this chapter is now in the Purushottam Yoga chapter, Lord Krishna has already described the inverted banyan tree. Do you all remember? From what I remember, the last time that I spoke at this venue, like this on a Friday, was indeed the Purushottam Yoga section, if I recollect correctly, something like that. Inverted banyan tree. And it is mentioned that all the jivas are situated on the various branches of the inverted banyan tree. Some are above, some are below. So based upon the various gunas, if you are on a lower guna, you are in a lower branch. If you are in a higher guna, you are in a higher branch. So gunas, tamo, rajo, sattva. Now, if you understood the banyan tree, if you understood the banyan tree and you understood the gunas, the natural question will arise, okay, here we go. I'm stuck here. Thank you for letting me know. It's not a very pleasing thought. It's actually quite depressing to know we are stuck. Now, could you please also offer me a way to get out of this banyan tree? We're like monkeys caught up in a tree. How do I get out of this banyan tree is the question that Krishna is trying to answer. And the main message that he gives, he's in this chapter mostly describing people who are entangled in the modes of ignorance, passion and goodness. He spends very few verses in the beginning, maybe just a couple, to describe those who are in goodness. But he spends most of the chapter to describe those who are in the modes of ignorance and passion. Bhagavad Gita, the most auspicious book on the planet, the book which gives us the summary of all the Vedic literature. In the 700 verses, Lord Krishna decides that he wants to dedicate few choices verses for the sake of those who are in mode of ignorance and passion. Does it seem right? Why waste these invaluable verses of those who are caught up in modes of passion and ignorance? Why waste them on the demons? Right? The word demon shall appear here. Prabhupada will give a wonderful definition of what a demon is. Right? His definition of demon is one who does not follow the Vedic injunctions. Period. Unfortunately for us, those who are, we are all, you know, enamored by the idea of a demon, with those who have two horns here, long teeth here, their nails are long and ready to devour you. That's our notion of demon. But Lord Shri Krishna, very mercifully, in this chapter, allows us to observe the demons which are residing in our heart, in the form of these various modes, lower modes, which are creating demoniac nature in us. And Prabhupada says, it said, one should use his human life properly to faithfully follow Shastra. Vedic injunction is Shastra. If we can focus our life in following Shastra, how do we do that? While avoiding lust, anger and greed. And to at least gradually elevate himself towards Krishna consciousness. Srila Prabhupada's purport carries to a conclusion concepts that Krishna has been developing in the last several chapters. And in the specific in the purport, Srila Prabhupada says, please hear carefully. This is the conclusion of the chapter. We'll touch upon the conclusion and then we'll see how the whole chapter develops into this conclusion. In human society, aversion to the principles of, I'll request everybody to hear, pay attention please. Whatever your services may be at this point in time, the service of hearing Bhagavad Gita, especially Srila Prabhupada's words, is foremost important. In human society, aversion to the principles of understanding the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the cause of all fall downs. Cause of all fall downs. That is the greatest offense of human life. We read 10 offenses just now to the holy name. Prabhupada said the greatest offense of human life is what? Aversion to the principles of understanding the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which could also mean being unattentive, inattentive while Bhagavad Gita recitation is going on. That's an aversion to hear, to understand Krishna. Because the only way we can understand Krishna is through Srila Prabhupada's writings. Let's read on. Therefore, Maya, the material energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is always giving us trouble in the shape of the threefold miseries. This material energy is constituted of the three modes of material nature. One has to raise himself at least to the mode of goodness before the paths to understanding the Supreme Lord can be opened. Without raising oneself to the standard of the mode of goodness, one remains in ignorance and passion, which are the cause of demoniac life. Those in the modes of passion and ignorance deride the scriptures, deride the holy man, and deride the proper understanding of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They disobey the instructions of the spiritual masters and do not care for the regulation of the scriptures. In spite of hearing the glories of devotional service, they are not attracted. Offense number 10. Just right now. Offense number 10. Not attracted. Glories of devotional service. Thus, they manufacture their own way of elevation. I will perform this kind of worship, I'll do this and that, and I will elevate. Prabhupada is saying one thing, and we want to manufacture our own ways of elevation. These are some of the defects of human society which lead to the demoniac status of life. If one is able to be guided by a proper and bona fide spiritual master who can lead one to the path of elevation, to the higher stage, then one's life becomes successful. To take the shelter of a bona fide spiritual master, then follow under him the regulations of the scriptures, first we have to read and then follow, is the only way we can protect ourselves with the modes of ignorance, passion, and goodness that we are endowed with. And that is the main message. Following scriptures under the guidance of a spiritual master is the solution, the key which will unlock the miseries. It is the magic formula which Krishna gives, that if you're caught up in that tree, you follow this magic formula, like a bird, we all can fly from this inverted banyan tree, go all the way to Goloka Vrindavan. Okay? So that's the context, and in that message, main message, now we'll see how this chapter develops through the verses to this indication. And we'll start now with verse number 1, 2, 3. I will request whoever is reading, please try to be a little bit expeditious so that we can cover the subject matter in English as well. So one devotee can take and they can continuously then read the verses in Sanskrit, please.
श्रीभगवान उवाच अवयम सत्व सुख संबुद्धि ज्ञान योग व्यवस्थित आनंद मचि नित्यश्च स्वाध्याय स्तप आजवम अहिंसा सत्यम क्रोधस्त्याग शांतिर पैशुनम या भूतेश्व लोलुपम आदवम शिरचापलम तेजक्षमाद तीर्षौचम दोहो नातिमानिता अवंती संपदा दैवम.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, fearlessness, purification of one's existence. Now, Krishna begins this chapter first by describing the 26 qualities. And these are the qualities that are demonstrated by those who are in the mode of goodness. These are the qualities of those who are defined as divine. These are divine qualities. To the extent that we have these qualities, we are divine. Just like we'll see later on, to the extent we have demoniac qualities, we are demons. None of us are categorically divine or demons. You know, it's not like one person is demon and no. Typically at our stage, we are all composed of various gunas and its pushings. And as long as we develop these qualities, we have divine nature. I will read these qualities. Srila Baladev Vidyabhushan, in his commentary, has gone into detail, and all the 26 qualities that you read here, he has done an analysis that in the Varnashrama system, the four Varnas and the four Ashramas, each of these qualities are said, which, whether it is for a Varna, predominantly seen in a Varna, let's say a Brahmana or a Kshatriya or a Vaishya Shudra, or in the Ashrama. Depending upon the ashram that you're in, Brahmachari, Grihastha, Vanaprastha, or Sannyasa. So I would request, especially those who are studying Bhakti Shastri, to do that analysis. You can refer to Baladev Vidya Bhushan's commentary, where he gives all 26 qualities. But we'll just simply read the 26 qualities for encouragement, so that we can aspire for these qualities and hear them out. Fearlessness, purification of one's existence, cultivation of spiritual knowledge, charity, self-control, performance of sacrifice, study of the Vedas, austerity, simplicity, non-violence, truthfulness. And when I'm reading these, please also observe in the mirror of our hearts, where do we stand on these qualities? Very important. I'm already tired. I'm thinking, Hare Krishna, what is the expectation? Very high. Freedom from anger, renunciation, tranquility, aversion to fault finding, compassion for all living entities, freedom from covetousness, gentleness, modesty, steady determination, vigor, forgiveness, fortitude, cleanliness, and freedom from envy and from the passion for honor. These transcendental qualities of son of Bharata belong to godly men endowed with divine nature. So all of you godly men and women, followers of Lord Shri Krishna's parampara, we all have to cultivate these qualities. If you have it, wonderful. For a person like me, I don't have any. So we have to cultivate this. That is the expectation of Bhagavad Gita. To be even categorized as divine. Lord Shri Krishna is not even talking about bhakti yet. This is just simply in the levels of modes. He's not talking about Shuddha Sattva. He's talking about, if you want to be divine, this much you must need to have. So every morning we get up, we look at the 26 qualities, we look at where we stand. Every evening we look at the 26 qualities and we look at where we stand. It will be a good barometer of our progress. In the beginning of the 15th chapter, the banyan tree of the material world was explained, right? The extra roots coming out of it were compared to the activities of the living entities, some auspicious and some inauspicious. This goes on. In the 9th chapter also, the devas or godlies and the asuras, the ungodly and demons, were explained. If you notice, in Bhagavad Gita up till now, there are many chapters where Lord Krishna specifically describes the qualities of divine and also his devotees. Most of the chapters, you'll see, my devotee, he's not envious, he's not enemy. He has so many chapters, almost every chapter in between, you'll see he's defining qualities. But in this case, he's giving a reverse reflection, allowing us to weed out those which are unwanted things. So this chapter, now soon, Krishna, immediately after 3 verses, let's read the 4th verse and see what Krishna jumps into straight away.
Dambhodarpurimanasya krodha parshiva evacha arshamem evacha ajnanam chavijatasya arthasampadamasuri.
Pride, arrogance, conceit, anger, harshness, and ignorance. I repeat, pride, arrogance, conceit, anger, harshness, and ignorance. These qualities belong to those of demoniac nature, O son of Pritha. I request once again, everybody, please hear. Whatever your services are, they're not so important that we cannot hear Srila Prabhupada's Bhagavad Gita. Everything can wait. In fact, if the desire to hear is not arising in our heart, it is indicative of an anartha. It is an indicator. If we cannot hear, means our path to progress is completely blocked with a bulldozer. Not like a wall, it's like a bulldozer, it's a reverse. So please try to hear. My words are insignificant, they're useless. But what Prabhupada says, at least pay attention. Now, if you look at the purport, very important purport, very important. This purport, please pay specific attention. If you can understand this purport of the fourth verse is a sutra for demoniac qualities. For Asuric Bhava, this is fourth verse is a sutra. Then after, from seventh verse all the way to 20th verse, Krishna will unpack this Asuric Bhava. But fourth verse, he gives the sutra. And Prabhupada in the fourth verse purport has very kindly given an eye-opener. And this is a big eye-opener, please bear in mind, especially for those who are engaged in the matter of preaching Krishna consciousness. Very, very important. Very, very important. You will be surprised how our demoniac nature is opened up in front of our eyes by Srila Prabhupada. And I'll read. Hear every single word. In this verse, the royal road to hell is described. The demoniac want to make a show of religion and advancement of spiritual science, although they do not follow the principles. They are always arrogant or proud in possessing some type of education or so much wealth. In our case, sometimes what we know from Bhagavad Gita, what we know from Bhagavatam becomes our reason for pride. We think this is our abhushana. They desire to be worshipped by others and demand respectability. People should say Hare Krishna to me. When I walk into the room, everybody should notice me. Although they do not command respect. Respect comes from the character of a person, not from the position. I'm also explaining a little bit. But Prabhupada, they do not command respect. And listen to this, over trifle. Trifle means small thing. Very, very small, insignificant thing. Over trifles, they become very angry and speak harshly, not gentle. They do not know what should be done and what should not be done. They do everything whimsically, according to their own desire, and they do not recognize any authority. If you want to find out a person who is misled on the path of bhakti and is actually not bona fide, ask them, who is your authority? If the answer is, somebody in a distance, then all of these will manifest. One's authority means one who's under whose direction are we working. Not broadly, grossly speaking. Specifically, who's my authority? If you ask me now, I can tell you exactly who my authority is and which of my service. I don't have any single service in my life where I don't have authority. But I'm so unfortunate, I still have these nature. Still. I have all these bad qualities. But if you don't have authority, then definitely you will have it. Definitely. Right? So, these demoniac qualities are taken on by them from the beginning of their bodies in the womb of their mothers. And as they grow, they manifest all these inauspicious qualities. If you want to know what happens in the womb of a mother, if you are a demon, read the section of Bhagavatam where Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu, third canto towards the end, when this whole incident described, and how they're in the womb for 100 years, and while in the womb they start creating so much problem, and once they come out, this whole description here is exactly that. When they come out, then what happens? When they walk, the whole earth shakes, etc. These are not just phantasmagorias, just some mythical thing. These are actual facts. They were Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu, and those who are still harboring these divine demoniac qualities in their heart, including ourselves, we are those small Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipus in the dress of Vaishnavas. Very, very careful. We have to be. So now, after this verse, Krishna has given a sutra. And I request all of us who are engaged in this movement for Srila Prabhupada, for preaching, please, 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 we must all read this verse and observe in our character, am I being protected from these qualities or not? Qualities, or what do I call this? Word, English, quality. Quality naturally has a connotation of positiveness, but let's say bad qualities. We have to protect ourselves. Immediately after saying this, Arjuna is described these three verses for good divine. One verse sutra for demon, and now completely demons create disturbance. So a thought arises in Arjuna's mind. I am going to now fight a war against all my relatives. Do I fall in this category? That question will arise, right? Because fighting, killing, all of that, that to my own family member, that thought will arise in Arjuna's mind. In order to address that, Krishna immediately speaks the fifth verse. He speaks the fifth verse and he quells or calms the concern of Arjuna. So let's hear in Sanskrit the fifth verse.
Jaya sampad mukchaya nibandhaya surimata mashucha sampadam daivyam daivim abhijato safandava.
The transcendental qualities are conducive to liberation, whereas the demoniac qualities make for bondage. Do not worry, O son of Pandu, for you are born with the divine qualities. So immediately pacifies Arjuna. You know, Arjuna is shivering now. What? Seems like I am, you know, describing this. Whenever I read this, I feel, oh Krishna, demon personified, standing here, what to do? So Krishna gives pacification. Arjuna is divine qualities. He addresses that. Lord Krishna encouraged Arjuna by telling him that he was not born with demoniac qualities. His involvement in the fight was not demoniac. Why was it not demoniac if somebody was to present an argument to all the Bhakti Shastris? Because he was considering the pros and cons. And if you take the sutra that I gave you at the end of the chapter, he was working under the direction of a bona fide spiritual master. Krishna, in the second chapter, takes some argument based upon Dharma Shastra, Artha Shastra and Bhakti Shastra and convinces Arjuna that you are acting according to Shastra. And Arjuna's acting according to Shastra and he's working under the direction of the Supreme Spiritual Master. For these two reasons, he has no reason to worry that he is under any demoniac influence. He was considering whether respectable persons such as Bhishma and Drona should be killed or not. So he was not acting under the influence of anger, false, prestige or harshness. Therefore, he was not of the quality of the demons. So that is the explanation that we offer. Even one with a demoniac nature, now let's assume we have a demoniac nature, which is a reality. Tell me one person who can stand here and say, no, I don't, I fall at your feet if you don't. But Krishna is explaining here that even one with a demoniac nature can change his qualities, because one's qualities develop according to one's association. By associating with those overwhelmed by lust, anger and greed, we will become lusty, angry and greedy. These words are important, these three words, because towards the end of the chapter, you will see how Krishna will describe lust, anger and greed as the three gates to hell. Okay, so he's introducing that. Then again, we can develop perfect qualities by associating with the perfect guru, sadhu and shastra. Srila Prabhupada once gave, once one person asked, they approached Srila Prabhupada and they asked, Srila Prabhupada, how can I become more sincere in Krishna consciousness? What do you think Srila Prabhupada's response was? Srila Prabhupada said, very nice example, very nice answer, Prabhupada. Very, you know, like sometimes we go, Maharaj, how can I become more humble? So, I was shared with this example. Maharaj said, first you become humble. Maharaj, how can I become more humble? First you become humble. So, Prabhupada said, how do I become more sincere? Prabhupada, very nice, he says, how do you become a drunkard? He said, if you will be a drunkard, then you'll become, people who drink, then you'll become a drunkard. Now, if you want to become sincere, then take association of the sadhus who are sincere. Very simple formula. Make an association, take sangha of those who are very sincere. Nectar of instruction very clearly says, whichever stage you are in, find a sadhu who is at stage higher than you. Otherwise, you'll be stuck. You'll not make any progress. You have to find sangha of those who are more elevated than you. And then they will pull us up. They will pull us up. Okay? So this was Prabhupada's answer. Drunkard. Whoever likes to drink or was drinking before, always remember the drunkard example. We'll go to proceed to verse number 6 now. Sanskrit.
Dobhut sargo lokesmin devasura evacha.
So, O son of Pritha, in this world there are two kinds of created beings. One is called divine and the other demoniac. One is called Sura, other is called Asura. Deva and the other called Asura. I have already explained to you at length the divine qualities. Now hear from me of the demoniac. So, Krishna says, I have explained to you in detail in the beginning of this chapter, the 26th. And before that, in various places, the qualities of a devotee have also been described by him. Now he focused his attention on demoniac. The essential distinction Prabhupada has made now, this is the distinction I shared with you. In this purport of verse 6, Prabhupada makes this claim. He says, the essential distinction between the demoniac and divine is adhering to Vedic literature. Very simple. If we are following Shastra in our activity, in any activity we do, if we are following Shastra, then we are on the divine path. If you are not following Shastra, I am making up things the way I want to do it, whimsically, then that falls into demoniac. So the question arises now, what do I do? I don't know whether to this activity and every day I get up and I drive my car, is there a Shastra for driving cars? Find out, I'm sure there will be. My point is, do not be ignorant. We should not be ignorant. We should seek for every activity we do in our life. We should seek what is the right way of doing this. If we have that strong desire, then we'll be on the right path of the divine path. There is no other criteria but obedience to the regulative principles of scripture. That is the criteria to be applied, whether you are a Deva or Asura. Krishna himself will confirm the point at the end of the chapter, which I have already shared with you. Now, as I shared with you, from verse number 7 to verse number 20, Krishna will explain in detail the demoniac nature. And we'll go through this a little bit swiftly, but carefully. Because it is not for others. It is not for those karmis in the Maya who don't know what Krishna is now. No, it is for us. All of the words, Krishna is speaking to Arjuna. So it is for our benefit. So we'll do verse number 7, please.
Pravittim cha nivittim cha jananam jasura na saucham na pichacharo na satyam cheshu vidyate.
Those who are demoniac do not know what is to be done and what is not to be done. Neither cleanliness, nor proper behavior, nor truth is found in them. Of the four pillars of religion, cleanliness and truth, two of the important pillars, have already been described. You will not find a trace you will not find. You will find what we call duplicity. Saying one thing on the face, doing something else behind. That's called duplicity. Krishna will later state directly that actions performed without proper discrimination between right and wrong are symptomatic of the mode of passion, a mode with which demoniac are richly endowed. So, if we are acting whimsically, these are symptoms that we are influenced very much by mode of passion and ignorance. Remember the context. This chapter is in the context of the inverted banyan tree. In the banyan tree, different jivatmas, spirit souls, are situated based upon the modes, mixture of modes. Predominantly sattva here, predominantly rajo here, predominantly tamo here. And if you cultivate higher modes, then you go up. If you cultivate lower modes, you go down. Urdhvam gacchanti sattvasta. Madhyam tishtanti rajasa. Jatanaguna vrittista adho gacchanti tamasa. Right? On the same banyan tree. So, now Krishna is describing. Whatever you have seen, we are all, our hardware or software is completely influenced by the modes that we are born with. And each one of us are born with different modes, combination. If we can somehow or the other decipher this thing about modes and which mode is influencing us, then it will be a good starting point for us to figure out how to protect ourselves from the influence of that particular mode. Right? So this chapter, and especially the next chapter, 17th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, is dedicated so that we can all individually, we don't have to ask anybody, we can individually identify based upon our faith, based upon what we eat, based upon the sacrifice, based upon the charity, and based upon the penance. Which mode are we in? And once we know, then we have to very carefully protect ourselves from it. So, now, another very nice story is given in this verse. The instruction is given that even if a demon propounds a philosophy, its value is compared to the preaching of the vulture and the jackal. See, sometimes with our demoniac nature, we'll be giving big, big philosophies. We'll be sitting on Vyasasana, giving nice, big lectures, big philosophy. But Prabhupada says, this is the nature of a jackal and vulture. You know, once a dead body, one young boy died. Young boy was dead. And his body was lying, and the whole family was gathered to perform the last sacrifice on the bank of a river or something like that. Right? Now the night was coming. So both, first the jackal came, and then after that the vulture came. The jackal came and started giving very high-flying philosophy to the family members. What is this body? Body is nothing. It's just the spirit soul you should be worried about. Why are you wasting your time in burning this body? You should just go home and chant Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Leave this body for me, I'll lead. He didn't say that. No, obviously. Then the vulture saw from a distance. Vulture have a very sharp eye. He saw, oh, such a nice thing is going on, you know, wonderful. So many people are dedicated to Krishna. How I can exploit these people for myself? So he saw from a distance the vulture and said, zoosh! Why are you listening to a jackal? You don't know jackals? They're most conniving. I will tell you real philosophy. So then the vulture went off. So this nice Udesh was going on between the jackal and the vulture and the family members. And it is written, regardless of the specific words spoken, the vulture, the jackal, and the demoniac speak philosophy only to achieve their selfish ends of love, puja, and pratishtha. You know the story of Jackal and Hyde? Jackal and Hyde? The kids would know. Jackal and Hyde is like a man who turns into a jackal. Inside he's a jackal, but he appears like a man. It's an English story of jackal and hyde. So we should not be jackal and hyde. We should not have this propensity of jackal and vultures. When we come to a sangha, when we come to Krishna consciousness, if we are given by Srila Prabhupada's mercy the opportunity to propagate the glories of the holy name, our dedication should completely be without any motivation for na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, kavitam, va jagadish mamay, mama janmani, janmani, ishvare, bhavatar, bhakti rahi tuki thwe. And we have to help each other. We have to observe of each other that we do not fall victims of this trap of maya. Because we are influenced by modes. And Prabhupada has described in his purport how these modes act on normal human beings, and which includes us. So we have to be careful. We'll go ahead and now read verse number 8.
Asatyam apatistham te jagat ahutam ishwaram apaspar sambhutam kim anyat kam ahetukam.
They say, who say, who is they here? Those who are demoniac. They say, this world is unreal. With no foundation, no God in control. They say it is produced of sex desire and has no cause other than lust. Eat, drink and be merry. I come across so many. Most of my ex-friends, you know, most of my college mates, my friends from IIT and other places who are well-to-do, their motto in life is, eat, drink and be merry. Why bother about this? You know, that is real life, man. After work, if you go to London, where I'm coming from now, every street has 10 bars. And what is the culture? British culture. Very, very advanced people, right? Gentlemen. Good morning, man. May I open the door for you? All drunkards. It's basically certified, authorized, bona fide in UK that after UK and also in Japan, which I also experienced, both places, after the work is finished, men and women in the office must go and have a couple of beers. That's part of your daily routine, your regulative principles every day. Right? So This is happening. This is not for, we can see from our eyes, this is the nature of people today. So it's not talking about some history or some future. Bhagavad Gita is talking about present. So we have to be very careful about such people who consider this to be the foundation. Next verse, please. The next 10 verses will describe when you have such a mentality. What kind of mentality? That there is no foundation, only there is no God, and only the sex desire is the main. Then the next 10 verses I will describe to you now what is the mentality and sort of actions these people perform. Okay?
Etam Ristim Avastavya Nastamano Alpa Buddhaya Tavant Yugra Karmana Shai Jaito Hita.
Following such conclusions, the demoniac who are lost to themselves and who have no intelligence engage in unbeneficial, horrible works meant to destroy the world. And Srila Baladev Vidyabhushan says in this commentary that he specifically says they come up with philosophies. They come up with different kind of religious philosophies to misguide the population away from Krishna. So he's not only talked about gross demons, he's talked about religious demons. Prabhupada said, anybody who takes you away from Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead in the form of Krishna, if he takes you away, he is a biggest rascal and the biggest demon according to Bhagavad Gita. If you propound a philosophy which does not allow you, or which does not force you to surrender to Krishna's lotus feet, then you are a demon.
Like Charvaka.
Charvaka. Butter. ghee. Eat as much. As much. That's the purpose of life. But Balade Vidya Bhushan wants, he wants. Let's move on, Prabhuji.
Kama Ashita Dushpuram Dhamma Manamano Madhavata Mohad Kriha Visad Krahan Navartante Suchitata.
So, as I said, the symptoms are described, the mentality and actions are described of these people. Not only do they propound religiously flawed philosophies, what do? Taking shelter of insatiable lust and absorbed in the conceit of pride and false prestige, the demoniac, thus illusioned, are always sworn to unclean work, attracted by the impermanent. We will proceed to the
Chittam Pranyam Cha Trayantam Upashitaha Samu Bhut Paramam Etavati Nishchitaha Asha Pasha Tarvetha Kam Bhut Paranana Tirhante Kam Bhogan Martya Anyayena Sardhak Sankhyan.
Asha Pasha Shatir. Asha Pasha. How they entangle. They believe, to demoniac, they believe that to gratify the senses is the primary necessity of human civilization. How many of us are living our life according to this formula? I am sitting here. That this is the prime necessity, satisfy my senses. Okay, I will do Krishna also. I will do Hare Krishna. But prime necessity of life is satisfy my senses. Thus, until the end of life, their anxiety is immeasurable. Anybody in anxiety? All of us? What is the cause? Less like in the Bhagavatam class, there was a question. What is the cause of krodha? How to control anger? What is the cause of anxiety? Not knowing Krishna. Not serving Krishna. And to have, to think that the necessities of human life are my main purpose. Bound by network of Asha Pasha Shatir, bound by networks of hundreds and thousands of desires and absorbed in lust and anger, they secure money by illegal means for sense gratification. One trick you can do, huh? You can, especially at the time of chanting, take a piece of paper and list down all your desires. They come up in good quantities during that time. At the time of chanting, all the desires will appear in your mind. List down the list. I can guarantee you, whatever long page you will take, it will not finish. Guaranteed. iPhone 1, iPhone 2, iPhone 3, iPhone 4, iPhone 5, iPhone 6, iPhone 7, iPhone 8, iPhone X, Y, Z. Then they will start with A, B, C, D, E, F. I'm just giving an example. This is how it goes on. This is the, and unfortunately, today's civilization is structured for the purpose of creating more and more desires, which shall help you understand that the prime necessity of life is to satisfy my senses, which according to Bhagavad Gita is the poison that we have to protect ourselves from. And about securing money with illegal means, you must be thinking, oh, as long as I am not participating in a slaughterhouse, my money is legal. Sorry to burst your bubble. One time, many years back, some of the devotees who are present here would remember, we were hearing a lecture from Bhakti Charu Maharaj. Many years, maybe now 11-12 years back, here in Kuwait, where Maharaj was very nicely described, and we were shocked. He described this extraction of oil. He's like sucking the blood out of Mother Earth. And he says, they have to pay a huge price for this activity. Do you remember? Anybody remember? Yeah. That's it. So, if you are all associated with activity, look again, Ugra Karma is coming our way. Who are you treating? Hare Krishna, I'm sorry, I'm just making light of the situation.
I'm just making light of this. I'm just saying, the scripture is very particular. Those who are on this path would like to simplify their life, would want to get away from this Ugra Karma activity, and do activities which don't attract Ugra Karma. Important. Let's go on to read the next few verses, Prabhu.
Idam adhyamaya labdham, imam prapse manoratham, idam asitam apime, bhavishyati punardhamam, asomaya hatashatru, nihashe chaparanapri, ishwaro aham bhogi, siddho aham padman suki.
Finished? 15th also finished?
Adyo abhijavanasmi, ko anyo asti sadrishyo maya,
The demoniac person thinks, I told you Krishna will talk about mentality. He talked about his activities and mentality. Now he's talked about how he thinks. So much wealth do I have today, and I will gain more according to my schemes. Anybody planning for more wealth? So much is mine now, and it will increase in the future. Anybody is investing? More and more. He is my enemy, and I have killed him. And my other enemies will also be killed. I am the Lord of everything. Ishvara aham, aham bhogi. I am the enjoyer, I am perfect, powerful and happy. I am the richest man, surrounded by aristocratic relatives. There is none so powerful and happy as I am. I shall perform sacrifices, I shall give some charity, and thus I shall rejoice. In this way, such persons are deluded by ignorance. For us, this is dream life, isn't it? Surrounded by nice family members, aristocratic life, and every comfort is there. There is wealth, and more wealth is coming. Who wants to complain? Anybody would complain? Bhagavad Gita is complaining. What to do? Prabhupada is saying, in this way, such persons are deluded by ignorance. Ignorance means effect of tamo guna and rajo guna. Gunas are acting and they're blinding us. They don't even allow us to see that this is a problem, Baba. This is the problem. This is not your benefit or your blessing. This is actually the problem which is causing you to suffer here in Janma Mrityu Jara Vyadhi. You've got to exit from here. So, when you have so many things, do you have a very good life? We think so, right? We all feel, if we get all of this, this position, this kind of a situation that Krishna has just given, our life will be excellent. Right? Krishna dispels that in the next verse. Let's look at verse number 16. Because what arises when you have all of this?
Anekachitta vibhranta moha jala samavritaha prasaktaha kama bhogeshu patanti narke ashchau.
So the demoniac were thinking, this is my achievement. I have achieved so much, right? Killed all the enemies, so much money, more will come. I am so powerful, I am the Lord and everything. But Krishna says, you want to hear what is their real achievement? Their real achievement? Thus perplexed by various anxieties and bound by a network of illusion, they become too strongly attached to sense enjoyment and fall down into hell. Fall down into hell. This is what happens to their life. This is their achievement. Now imagine, after all the jhamela, if somebody was to say, thank you so much, sir, now time to go to hell. Will you appreciate that offer? How many want? We have nice description, Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto. Very nicely, there are at least just like 26 qualities are given here. We'll offer you 26. Primary hell. There are more hellish planets. There's a complete planetary system. 26 different kinds are ready. Hellish planets are ready. Krishna says, don't be in ignorance. Your gati is not param gati. It is durgati. It is fixed. There is no doubt. Asamshaya. There is no doubt in this. Completely fixed, Krishna says. This is fixed for you if you have this mentality. Then he goes on in 17th and 18th verse. Prabhu, please read.
Atasambhavita stabdha jatanmana madvantaha yante nama yajyaste tambhe namadhi purvakam.
18th also, please.
Ahankaram balam darpam kamam krodham cha samshutaha matatmam padeheshu tadvishanto abhyasuyakaha.
So Krishna continues to describe the mentality in these verses. As I told you, till 18th verse, he is describing the mentality of these people in demoniac nature. Self-complacent and always impudent, deluded by wealth and false prestige, they sometimes proudly perform sacrifice in name only, without following any rules or regulation. These statements of Krishna, which he is given in verse number 15 and 17, of how they perform charity, how they perform sacrifices, shall become clear to us in chapter number 17, where Krishna will describe how people with different modes are performing sacrifice and charity. Okay? Bewildered by false ego, verse 18, bewildered by false ego, strength, pride, lust and anger, the demons become envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is situated in their own bodies and in the bodies of others, and blaspheme against the real religion. When it says bodies of others, means including Vaishnavas. So they blaspheme Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. This is what the demons do. Why do they do it? Because they become proud, envious. And very soon in the 21st verse, I shall describe to you how they come to this envy. Krishna describes. Till 18th verse, Krishna has described the mentality. Now Krishna will speak from his own words in verse number 19 and 20. In verse number 19 and 20, he will specifically declare what will happen to such individuals. Let's read 19 and 20, please.
Tan aham dushtah kuran samsareshu naratman chitrami ajasaram ashubhan ashura ashurishva evayonishu.
20 also, Prabhu.
Asuri yonim papinna mudha janmani janmani mam prapeva konteya tato yantu dhamavati.
So those who are envious and mischievous, Krishna is saying, who are the lowest among men, Naradhama, I perpetually cast into the ocean of material existence into various demoniac species of life. So if primarily influenced by Rajogun, Madhyam Tishtanti, Rajasa, if primarily motivated by Tamogun, Adho Gacchanti, Tamasa. Attaining repeated birth among the species of demoniac life, O son of Kunti, such persons can never approach me. Gradually, they sink down to the most abominable type of existence. Can you imagine the plight of these people? See, if you lose the favor of your wife, you can still go out and eat in hotel. If you lose the favor of your boss, maybe you can get another job. If you lose the favor of your prime minister and president, maybe you can find another country to take exile in. But if you lose the favor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he is saying, I cast them into the lowest of lives. Where do you go? If you lose the shelter of Dina Bandhu, who will give you shelter? And if you continue to remain in these modes of ignorance and passion, Krishna is almost guaranteeing, not only with Prakriti, Krishna saying, I am going to cast them into the lowest of lives. Very severe warning, right? Now, somebody may say, Krishna, he is so all merciful, he should protect them, he should protect everybody, he should give shelter to these people also and everything. And it is written. Birth after birth they suffer, especially being born into lower species. Why does Krishna not give them shelter? Why? Because such souls have no desire to get out of material existence, they don't get out of material existence. They don't want Krishna's mercy, and he does not give them mercy. It's as simple as that. As simple as that. Look at the progression of the verses. Krishna left at a point where they have become envious of Guru, Sadhu and Shastra and Krishna himself, and they become envious of Vaishnavas. And to such people, cast them in the deepest regions of hell. If we are not envious, we are just influenced by modes, there is still a chance. The Vaishnavas can protect us. But if we are envious of the Vaishnavas, nothing left. Krishna guarantees. So argument will come, right? When somebody stops, "Yo, Krishna is so merciful, why doesn't he help them?" Because they don't want to be helped. See, if somebody's fallen in a well, and others are saying, "Help him, help him." Okay, I throw the rope to that person in the well, and the person looks at the rope, turns around. Is it my fault? Is it Krishna's fault if they're not latching onto the rope? And what is the rope? The rope is Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. That is the rope. Catch the rope. They're saying, this is dirty. I don't like this rope. Send me one made of gold, then I will think about it. By that time the water is rising, you will sink in the lowest of planets. That's the analogy that is given. So, Krishna, because they don't want his mercy, they don't get it. Now let's see what really opens up the doors to hell for these people. Verse number 21, very interesting verse.
Trividham narkasya ram dwaram ashram atmanaha kama krodha lobha tasmat etat trayam
trijayat. There are three gates leading to this hell: lust, anger and greed. Every sane man should give these up, for they lead to the degradation of the soul. Every sane man must give up lust, anger and greed. We are greedy, we are lusty, and we get angry. In order to make progress in our spiritual life, we have to close these doors to hell. We have to withdraw from being greedy for more and more and more and more. We have to withdraw from lust. And in this progression I described this morning in the Bhagavatam class also, there is a very simple progression I repeat here for the advantage of all the devotees. The main route, Hare Krishna, please listen to the discussion here. This Prabhu who is sitting on the book table, you must hear. Try. I said it three times before. Now I am telling you directly, requesting you. Hear. Everything else can wait. Hear. Lust, kama, is the root cause. Root cause is kama. If kama is not satisfied, it leads to krodha. Two directions. Take it like a flow chart. Here is kama. Kama not satisfied leads to krodha. Verse number, second chapter, verse number 62, 63 describes Khayato Vishan Pumsa Sangaste Shukajayate Sangat Sanjayate Kama. Kama krodha abhijayate. If it is not satisfied. If kama is satisfied, then shall we become happy? Everybody will say, yes, it's fine. Whatever I desire, it's okay. I'm smiling now. I'm dancing in kirtan. Everything is perfectly all right. Krishna says, satisfaction, trying to satisfy your vasana and kama, is like pouring ghee in fire. It will multiply. Then the second part of the flowchart starts. Kama which gets satisfied becomes lobha, greed. It turns into greed. Right? If this greed, it in the heart, it is increasing the greed. I remember very long time back, I heard one of Prabhupada's lectures, and Prabhupada said, you know, you want to know how good a devotee you are, or whether you're making progress in spiritual life or not, you don't have to ask anyone. All you have to see is whether kama and lobha is reducing in your heart or not. If our desires for bank balances have increased, then there is something wrong. Lobha means greed is increasing. For a sadhu, for one who's on the path of devotional service, it has to disappear. It has to go down. This is what Shastra is saying. If this lobha is cultivated in our heart, then it leads to moha, illusion. Krodhat bhavati sammoha, sammoha. Krodhat sammoha. If either krodh, if it is fulfilled, then it leads to sammoha, moha. It leads to illusion. Moha then leads to madha. Madha is known as madness. We are all mad after sense gratification. We are mad after a bank balance. We are mad after I want this and that and this and that. We don't show it to others. In our heart it is being cultivated. This is the second part of the flow chart. From kama, which is satisfied, lobha, lobha to moha, moha to madha. And that madha, eventually madness leads to matsaraha, envy, which is the cause of keeping us in this material world. That's how these three gates to hell work. They appear most attractive. Actually, from the surface, all three, lust, anger and greed, they are lovely. They are lovely. And they're just so superbly decorated. You really want to enter into that gate. Amazing. Who doesn't want to go here? But such is the mercy of Krishna and Srila Prabhupada. Krishna says, these are your three gates for hell. Protect yourself. So, if I was to avoid these three gates, okay, Krishna, I got your message, Bhagavan, lust, anger, greed, I should stay away from it. What will I get now? What will happen to me is described in the next 2-3 verses, which we shall read. Please read, Prabhu.
Ete vimuktah kaunteya tamodvaras tribhirnara acharya panahasheyasto yati param gati.
So the man who has escaped these three gates to hell, if you can somehow or the other turn your eyes, you know, we are hypnotized by those gates. Like they show in movies, no? Somebody comes and hypnotizes and you go, this is our state right now. We are all intoxicated in moha. If we can somehow or the other break that intoxication and hypnosis and we turn away, Krishna says, the man who has escaped these three gates of hell, O son of Kunti, performs acts conducive to self-realization and thus gradually attains the supreme destination. What are those acts of spiritual realization? Taking shelter of scriptures. Shastra is the foundation. Take shelter of the scriptures, understand, avoid all those demoniac tendencies, whimsical nature. Take complete shelter of scriptures. That's how they perform their life. Our choice is very clear. Prabhus and Matajis and the Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis and all kinds of devotees who are present here. Our choice is clear. Choosing to escape the banyan tree of the material world entails choosing to free ourselves from lust, anger, greed, illusion, pride and envy. Kaam, krodh, lobh, moh, mad, matsaraha. Krishna now, in the last two verses, will offer the conclusion of this chapter, which we already started with. First, he will give a negative effect. He will say negative statement. Krishna directs us to bring our activities in line with Shastra, he will give a negative idea. And then he will give a positive statement, which we read at the beginning of the chapter. So the negative idea, verse number 23.
Yah shastra vidhin utsarjya vartate kama karatah nasa siddhim avapnoti nasukham na param gatim.
And the positive idea also.
Tasmat shastra pramanam te karyakarya vyavasthitau jatva shastra vidhanoktam karma kartum yaha arhasi.
So the negative idea first, verse number 23 I am reading. He who discards scriptural injunctions and acts according to his own whims attains neither perfection nor happiness nor the supreme destination. What does he attain? Can you all tell me what does he attain?
Hellish lives.
Krishna himself casts them. Okay? And if we perform according to scripture, one should. So after giving this summary in the 23rd verse, he is now summarized everything. He gives 24th verse. Krishna says, one should therefore understand what is duty and what is not duty by the regulation of the scriptures. Knowing such rules and regulations, one should act so that he may gradually be elevated. Srila Prabhupada's purport shows the connection between not only following Shastra and acting in lust, anger and greed. So he gives the connection of how if you don't follow Shastra, you will be acting in the influence of lust, anger and greed. He does that. He says, as described before, the Shastra Vidhi or the direction of the Shastra is given to the different castes and orders of human society. This he is describing the Varnashram system. The Varnashram system, the different Varnas and different Ashramas, especially different Varnas are influenced by a combination of different modes of nature, Sattva, Rajo and Tamo. And for each Varna and Ashram, there are prescribed duties, directions given so that we can protect ourselves. Direction of Shastra is given. Everyone, small boy to the elderly gentleman, everyone is expected to follow these rules and regulations. If one does not follow them and acts whimsically according to his lust, greed and desire, then he will never be perfect in his life. In other words, hear this last sentence very carefully. Very important for all of us practicing sadhakas. In other words, a man may theoretically know all these things. But if he does not apply them in his own life, then he is to be considered known as the lowest of mankind. Very strong definition. There are those who don't know, but those who do, theoretically, we come, we hear, we read, and we don't apply, then according to Krishna and Srila Prabhupada, Naradhana. And what happens to them? Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Bhagavad Gita yatharup ki
jai.
So thank you so very much for participating in this discussion.